welcome to my studio and welcome to another edition of Art Discussion with me, Adelaide Damoah. I'm an artist, as you may know, and I really enjoy talking to other artists to find out how they overcome challenges that they have to overcome on a daily basis in order to achieve the things that they want to achieve in their careers, as well as some of the things that they're most proud of, some of their most important successes, how they've, the steps they've taken to achieve those successes. And I like to package that information up into video form and pass that information on to you. And my hope is that that you'll be inspired, or if you're an artist and you're wishing to follow your dream, or that if you are somebody who's just interested in art, maybe you'll discover a new artist that you've never heard of before. And that in some small way I can contribute to promoting the artists that I interview. Hence this series, Art Discussion. So, today's discussion is with a young man by the name of Robi Walters. And Robi is possibly, quite possibly, one of the nicest people you will ever meet. He's actually a unicorn. No, I'm not lying. You know those mythical creatures that don't actually exist? Yeah, well, he's real. Yes, and his name is Robi Walters. How did I meet Robi? Well, I came across Robi via an art dealer who came to see me sometime last year, so 2016. And we were just talking about different artists, and he showed me Robbie's work. I looked him up, and I said, Robbie seems like a really interesting artist. I'd like to interview him. And then I went to 154 Art Fair in October of 2016, and Robi had a very impressive room set up where he was showing his 365 project, which is basically a project whereby he makes a painting every single day, and he has been working on this project for the last 7 years. And after the end of each year, so 365 drawings or paintings, he puts them into a book, which he then, that's an original piece of artwork in and of itself. And each day corresponds to a piece of news, a piece of real news, like a headline that's happened in real life. So they're like these time capsules. Very, very interesting work. If you want some more information about that, click his link in the description bar below. Yes, so his degree course was very, if you know anything about that course, then you'll know that it is a lot, it's very design led, so there's a lot of computer work. And Robi was more interested in making fine art, so he would be more making work on canvas than working at the computer. And he went into the fine art world around 10 years ago, and has really been really pushing very hard ever since. Which brings us up to date, where he's got a very impressive career. He's got works in some important collections. He is represented by three major galleries, two in London. So he's got the Maddox Gallery in Mayfair, Waterhouse and Dodd in London, and Gallery Chauvy in Paris. So I think it's now time for me to pass you on to Robi so that you can see what he has to say. If you did click this interview, then you will have seen that it's an exceptionally long interview for me. It is about 30 minutes, but trust me, it's worth it. I could not bring myself to cut, couldn't bring myself to cut any of the stuff out because he says so many inspiring things I think is really important for you to hear. And to put it into two, it just wouldn't really make sense. Hence the reason why I've just kept it at this length. So anyway, do enjoy. In terms of the work that you're making now, could you summarize what it is that you're doing?
Yeah. So I've always wanted to make art, and I got to it quite late, if you like, because I went through a whole design career, if you like. I watched a documentary that was called Zeitgeist, have you seen that?
Yeah.
And I hadn't watched anything like that ever. And most people probably put it under the bracket of conspiracy, but I found it fascinating. Maybe some of it's true, maybe some of it's not, I don't know, but still it was fascinating. And it really internally shook me, my worldview of religion, money, and how war is created, or some people don't think it was creative, but you know, it is a business in a way. And I instead of pointing a finger and saying this system's bad or wrong, I was thinking, what can I do to turn the negative into a positive? Mm-hmm. And I was sitting in the kitchen, I remember seeing this pile of recycling, thinking, what happens to that? Like, where does it go? Does it actually get recycled? And then there was a piece of art, I think Leanne or Amanda, probably Leanne, and I remember seeing a flower with petals like cut out, and I was thinking, oh, it'd be nice to do like a really big one, like based on the chakra system, the 1,000 petal lotus. And I remember cutting out these petals out of this recycling and then sticking them around the outside. And I think I got two sides round, and I was like, am I mad? Like, this is taking forever. Like, what am I doing? And I just kept on going. And then I made it. And I called that the first one Zeitgeist. And when I completed it, I wasn't sure if it was any good. And the same with a lot of the stuff that I first do, like, I'm not entirely convinced that it's any good. I have to kind of keep going and get past my internal dialogue of my own judgment. And when I made that piece, I made a couple more, and then the more I was doing, I found it's actually therapeutic as opposed to it being frustrating. And it was more time to reflect or a time to listen to something, music or interview. And then I started to learn. So I would play music and listen to an interview whilst working. And those three different disciplines, I found that if I went on my bike for a ride and I listened to the same piece of music, the memory came back of what I was listening to. So I think you could probably learn faster if there's sound or if there's distractions, which is contradictory to if you're at school, it's like silence in the room, one person at the front. Whereas I'm thinking, you know, you can have multiple things going on where we're learning much quicker. And I think so it led me to a lot of different things, like very quickly. And it's also something that I can do with other people now. So it's really community. Yeah, I love it.
Yeah.
I really enjoy it.
Yeah, it's nice. So what would you say you've mentioned the whole thing of Zeitgeist, and Zeitgeist being the spirit of the times, and obviously you've got the books, the 365 books, which you've been making for the last 7 years, right? So they're kind of an element of, you know, labor, patience, and also while at the same time putting in all of that work every single day, creating something, and then linking it to what's going on in the news, literally capturing the spirit of the times, in art. Am I correct?
You are. I think that I went and so I started my the 365 project was inspired by Chris Ofili. So he was like a mentor before I started doing my work, and I would speak to him. I was living in Canada at the time, and I'd speak to him like once a month for like four times. And then I was asking him how I would start, and this is advice to anyone. I mean, I just had the you know, fortunate to speak to someone that had won the Turner Prize and a YBA, and he said to me, draw every day. And that was the most important thing for him, his message to me. And I didn't want to draw every day because I wanted to make art. So I started doing these tiny little doodles. They got bigger and bigger and bigger. And before I knew it, I did this 12-foot drawing. And I was like, wow, how did I get here? And then I realized accumulated small steps create big things. And I think that in today's world, with social media, with the way that we view television, a lot of reality TV shows, it's instant fame. And it's instant this and instant. And I'm like, you know what? That's for like 0.0001% are going to have that. That's going to work for them. But for the rest of us, there is a way. And it's practice every single day. And you'll get there, but you're going to go through some tough things. So when I started my 365 project, I was thinking about it from September 2010. to the end of the year, and I started 1st of January 2011. I did a piece of work every day. And then I went, as I was doing the work, I went and saw someone who worked with Steve Lazaridis. And this is just kind of the separating time of Banksy with Lazaridis, that kind of thing was going on. His name was Rafe, and he was working, he worked in the auction houses, he was headhunted, so he knew what he was doing. And I went and saw him for advice. And I said, what's the difference between a good and a great artist? And said, this isn't the both perfect, but this is my opinion. So he was saying that in his view, a great artist, the work is undeniably good. You can't say it's not good. You might not like it, but there's something about it. It's shocking, so it's stuck in your mind. Again, you might not like it, like a shark in a tank or whatever it is, but it's shocking and it's stuck in your mind. Or it's anchored in something to do with our time. So people can say, oh, do you remember when? And it's anchored in a moment in time. So I took that element and I put it into my work. So I was like, I'm going to name my work a news headline from that day so that the work is anchored in human behavior, but catalogued from the documentation of human behavior, which is the news. But the news is quite negative. But that's a reflection of how we consume, how humans behave. So I started to put a digital footprint in my work, which is the news headline. So you can type that in, read the article from the day that I made the painting.
Wow. Okay, so can we just rewind, yeah, right, to when you said that Chris O'Feely,
yeah,
was your mentor?
Yeah.
How did that come about?
Do you know Charlie Dark?
Yes.
Yeah. Charlie Dark, he's a really good friend. Leanne and I, we used to design a club fly called Blacktronica.
Yes.
Yeah, which was at the ICA.
I used to go to Blacktronica.
Yeah, did you?
Back in the day, okay. Yeah.
So they had A-Side,
yeah,
who is now, you know, I think he's, you know, the most underground, one of the best DJs, you know, in what he does. Then you have Tick, who, you know, was the fact, you know, brought Adele to XL Recordings. You know, he started his own label. He's, you know, from lots and lots of people have come under his wing and become very successful. And they were like, so Tick, A-Side and Charlie Dark were like DJ. Then I came through someone called Dean Ricketts from the Watchman Agency. And there was a really concentrated group of people doing amazing things. So you had amazing DJs coming down, like my, you know, Full Hero, like Digo, people like that. And then you had like different art things going on, different live things going on. It was a really interesting time. And Chris was kind of on the outskirts of this. And there was a time where he had a drawing sent to us to use on a flyer. And it was one of the first times I actually realized how serious art was, because it was a tiny pencil drawing. And the Victoria Mural Gallery was like, you know, it's been with us a few hours, not even a day. And like, have you scanned in the image yet? Right, we're sending a courier to pick it up. It's like, whoa, these guys are serious. Like, for a tiny little drawing, it's like, you know, I'm only just getting into cataloguing and documenting my own work now with the help of an unbelievable team. Led by Katrina. But I think that Chris was just, when we met him, we went to his house, we saw his work, and when I saw his show at the Serpentine, when he got the Turner Prize, it blew my mind, his work. And to have met him, it was just like, he was just such a special, special, gentle, kind, generous person. And yeah, if you ever get a chance to talk to him, he's so humble, he's amazing.
We touched upon some of the things that you've achieved, mm-hmm, just touched upon them briefly, mm-hmm, but what would you say was the biggest, the most significant thing for you that you've achieved in your art career to date, and how did you achieve it?
There's a few different things. I think one that stands out is maybe making the first one that actually makes me pursue, keep going. I think really significant things, I know it kind of sounds funny, is that I love working with kids. I get a real buzz from, like, that real sense of you're doing something that has a meaning or a purpose when I do workshops with kids and you see them switched on, like, that just absolutely gives me a buzz. And my favourite artist is my daughter Amanda, and most weekends we find ourselves in here tinkering away and doing stuff, and she just does stuff that blows my mind, and that really stimulates me, like, to keep going. And with my own creation and my own work, I don't see it as work. It's I love it. I just love doing it. It just is something that comes natural. I don't, you know, I could go into the early hours of the morning and go, oh shit, I better go home, or it's not. I think if it was a crowning achievement, it's not the art itself, but it's discovering something that I'm so passionate about that I can actually live my life doing that. That's a blessing. Anyone that finds a passion that they can live their life and they're doing it, you're not really working. Not, yeah. You know, it's led me to some unbelievable situations, and I'm like, how did I get here? And it's like, because I'm doing something that I'm passionate about, and they want to be with someone that's passionate.
Yeah.
I'm not, and it's authentic. It's not like I'm trying to sell it to them. I'm just like, oh, this is what I'm doing, and I'm buzzing about it. Before you know it, it leads to something.
Yeah.
So I think if I was to say what I'm most proud of, it's discovering the art itself. It's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Some people, they never find that.
No, you're right.
Yeah.
And obviously we discussed earlier that this amazing studio right in the heart of Soho, and I'm really interested in how the whole thing came about and how you're managing to sustain a studio in the heart of Soho.
So when I was in Canada, when I moved back, before I moved back, in my head, I always think the clearer you are with the thing that you want, that thing will come. And I heard the saying, you can't hit a target you don't have. So when I was in Canada, I was like, I want a studio on Dean Street. It wasn't even like, I want a studio in Soho or in Central. I was like, I want it on this street in London. So I came back and then I worked from home. Then I got a studio in Cremer Street off of Kingsland Road, which is near Old Street. I didn't really like the area. Then I moved back home and then I went for a, I helped someone and I was driving a van, I dropped it on the rim and I was walking through Waterloo and I was looking around at the to let signs. I was like, oh, I should get a studio. And I was walking to a meeting and I went into the meeting and this lady said, oh, you don't know anyone that wants a studio, do you? I was like, where is it? And she said, Dean Street. I was like, you've got to be joking me. So I moved in and I was there for a couple of years, mostly by myself. It was subsidised. And then from there, I moved into a basement, Lexington Street. Then I moved to Langham Street. Then I moved to St. Anne's Court. Then I moved to Lexington Street again. Then I moved back here. So I've moved quite a few times.
Yeah.
But how you sustain it is, I have a really good relationship with someone where we have a really good understanding. And I pay in I pay in different ways. And the same with, like I mentioned before, getting into private members clubs. Like, they're expensive. And it's difficult to get in, but there are other ways. And through my art, it's opened up doors that I couldn't possibly imagine. So this studio is really an extension of my art.
Yeah. So it's more like a bartering kind of...
Bartering, payment, yeah. I do whatever it takes.
Yeah.
Whatever it takes, because I want... When I was doing graffiti, there was these two graffiti artists, Revenfield, this is back in the day, they said... graffiti is called bombing. So when you're doing a tag along, it's called bombing. So it's a military term. They said if you tag the center of a city, the footfall sees the tag a lot more, but it's high risk. If you tag the suburbs, not many people are going to see it, but you're probably not going to get in trouble. So if you're tagging these streets, there's a lot of cameras, a lot of police work, etc. So if I take that philosophy, if you bomb the centre, if I have a studio in the centre, the chances are people will come here. Say if you invite 10 people, I'll probably get 7 people come here versus if I'm, say, Edgware Road, or if I'm even Old Street or further, if I'm in Bethnal Green or somewhere, out of those 10 people, maybe I'll get 4. So it's like, if you can get your space in the center, I'd take a small space central over a really big space really far away. Mm. Because people come and see my work, and the more people that see your work, the more relationships you develop, the faster your career goes.
Yeah.
I'm not interested in really big space and loads of people spread out and big pieces. I'm interested in central, good relationships.
Yeah.
That's what I'm interested in.
Yeah.
I know it's like, I'm going to be completely honest. I know it sounds strange, but I have friends that are artists, but I don't seek friends that are artists. I like people that are passionate. That's really what I seek. I'm in an artistic environment and it's all about artists. I'm not really, like, if you could be in, like, when I meet someone that's in finance, I'm like, so what do you do? And they kind of like say it like it's not very interesting. Oh, you know, like, what? what, you're in finance? Yeah. Okay, tell me about that. What do you mean? I'm like, you know, explain to me what a derivative is. And they're like, well, this is what, I'm like, that sounds like gambling. And I'm like, but I'm interested.
Yeah.
And I think that they don't think that I'm interested, but you know, a job's a job. You know, there's not better ones or worse ones. I think, you know, you just got to find something that you're interested in the thing that you're doing.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, what would you say, I mean, how long have you been practicing now, by the way?
I started, so I went full-time September 2010.
That's not that long ago.
And most of that time I spent by myself.
Yeah.
So you're grafting, like, when things start to become a bit more successful, people judge you where you are, but I'm like, if you want this, you've got a lot of work, you know, you've got a lot of grafting, a lot of rejections, a lot of financial difficulty, you're tested.
Mm-hmm.
How bad do you want this? There's a part where once it gathers, you know, you're swimming against the current and that current changes and you're going with it, but you're tested. How bad do you want this? You know, I was speaking to a friend, he's a premier football player, and it's like, people say we're paid so much. He's like, dude, that, my life is given up. I can't, you know, I have to be careful what I consume in my body. I have to be careful what time I'm going to bed. I have to, all of my life, from like this, not like even teenager, from this, that's my life. I've given up my life to do this. And it's like, when you speak to a football player, on the outside, you see all the glitz and this and that, the cars, the going up. But behind the scenes, they put their time in. And I want to do the same. You know, I will quite happily be here when everyone's gone. I'll quite happily come in when it's the weekend. I don't even feel like I'm coming somewhere. I want to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What would you say has been the biggest challenge for you since you started, since you went full time? And how did you get past it?
Finance, real struggle. Hardcore, right at the beginning, hardcore. I had financial commitments that I couldn't meet, and I had a partner that helped me. And, you know, I will help her tenfold from doing that. I will help her tenfold. Because if you haven't got money, it's hard. And I don't care what people say, if you haven't got money, you act in a different way. And you're restricted. You're so restricted. But I never let that stop me from trying to achieve what I wanted to achieve. But I was very fortunate that I had someone that supported me.
Yeah.
That's a real thing.
Yeah.
It's difficult.
Yeah.
It's difficult.
Yeah.
But I couldn't have got it if I had a full-time job.
Yeah.
If I did, I wouldn't be doing this. I needed to 100% dedicate my absolute application and practice to this.
Mm.
But if I didn't, I wouldn't be doing this now.
Yeah, yeah. So, as a man of colour in an art world which is run by mainly white men, have you come across any discrimination? And if so, no, have you managed to get past
it? I have, yeah. And I try not to pay too much attention to it. There's one thing that it was, if I was to dwell on it, it could have knocked me a little bit. And I was with someone that witnessed it, and he was just like, Robbie, what's going on? And he was a serious player. He manages really big global stars, and he was trying to manage me at the time, and he really kind of was like, he gave me a good talking to afterwards, and he's a white male, but supportive. And you know, I don't play the race card too much, because I think I don't want to get trapped in my own framework that someone else has put me in. I'm like, that's your perspective. Like, we're the same. I'm going this way. So when people tell me I can't do something, that's inspiration. I don't like to become the victim in that situation.
Is institutional validation something that's important to you, art world institutional validation?
It's not important to me personally. It's important to the work. If you want to get to the top, you got to play a game. The game's changing. You can make your own rules, but there's guards at every door. And if you can't relate, communicate, you're not getting in. I'm not talking about art, I'm talking about in general. Like, there are doors that can be opened up to you, and you could just fly in any situation if you've got the right person to help you. You know, I think there's a lot with, it's not what you know, it's who you know. And it's like, develop those relationships, even if it's one person. If they're successful in something, develop, nurture it. Like, they're like gods to me. Like, if someone's successful, I don't care what business they're in, I want to spend time with them. I really do.
Yeah. And how do you define art world success?
Art world success. Success is a really broad term. I think that there's many ways to measure success. I think internal happiness, finding meaning, finding purpose, helping others, inspiring, that's success for me. Like, you could have nothing and you can still be successful for me. Financially, that's another one, but that's for other people. Oh, you've made it, you've got this. I'm like, I already made it before I started. Yeah. I knew I was getting that. I was successful back there, but you just couldn't see it. So success could be measured in different ways. And the world sees it from a outside. What you're wearing, where you live, where you're showing, who's buying, how much money, what car. That's their success. Internal is for me. Like, yeah.
If you could go back to 2010, when you first started down this road, what advice would you give yourself?
I would probably... There's not much more that I could have done, because I worked my ass off, but I would try to encourage myself. Like, I take risks. I take quite a few risks, but I'd encourage myself to do even more risk taking. Like, I've only just discovered putting on shows myself, and the rewards from doing that, I wish I'd done that sooner. I wish I'd built a team of people around me sooner. I wish I could have supported them earlier. I'm only just able to do this now, but taking risks, you got to do it. There's no reward. You're not going to, like, you know, what you're doing now, like, no one, is anyone telling you to do this?
No.
You're doing that off your own back.
Yeah.
Like, in a way, it's like your future self telling you you're going to be okay, just keep going. And that's how it is for me. It's like, I almost have to be, like, I know I'm going to get there. So it's from that place I'm talking to me from there. But I'm not there, but I'm talking from that place.
Yeah.
It's like, there is the sense of security. Here it's a sense of risk. Oh, I'm not sure. We was talking about the pricing of something earlier, and I was like, in my head, I'm kind of even further than that. But externally, I'm like, oh, I'm not sure. I'm very cautious. But internally, I'm like, I'm almost past that. It's funny, that one.
So take risks.
Yeah.
Okay. And what advice would you give to a new person now who's just entering the art world? What advice would you give them?
I think the best advice is what Chris said to me. Do it every day. Practice every single day. Whatever it is.
Hello, welcome back. Thanks very much for sticking through that interview with Robi Walters. I told you it was going to be a good one. I told you, and it really was. He gave an excellent interview, absolutely impeccable. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. If you have any burning questions that you'd like me to ask some of the other artists that I interview going forward, then please do put them in the comment section below and I will endeavour to include them in my list of questions that I get to ask these amazing artists. In the meantime, please do subscribe to the channel, and if you enjoyed this interview, please give me a thumbs up because it really helps me out. All right, until next time, take care. Bye.